These are the two important terms that you should be knowing: source text and target text. So we have been looking at that, and we also saw the role of translator, the role of translator, and then we saw what translation is, what interpretation is. We also saw interpretation was a subcategory of translation, etc., and the various problems that are involved in translating poetry, drama, short story, novel, etc. Okay, and the most problematic to be translated was poetry because of the poetic devices used in that, because of the rhymes, alliterations, assonances, all those things. Now, in unit 2, we will be looking at the link between translation studies and the various ways in which meaning is arrived at in the piece of work. See, we have taken a book to be translated. We have taken a book to be translated. Let us suppose it is in English, and let us suppose that we are going to translate it in one of our local languages, vernacular languages, maybe Tamil or Hindi, or one of the Indian languages. So, if we have planned to translate an English textbook, an English novel, into Tamil or Hindi or any other local language, then the book that we have selected for translating is called as the source text, ST. Okay, source language, SL. Source language would be English, and the language in which we are going to translate will be target language. So these are two key terms that we should be knowing in translation paper. Okay, so in this unit, we are going to look at why linguistics is important for the study of translation. Why linguistics is important? What is the connection between linguistics and translation studies? So, to first of all, in this chapter, the author has concentrated on the meaning. Okay, the scientific term for meaning. I hope all of you have some notebook and pen with you to take down the notes, because many important concepts are being introduced. So it's better if you have the notebook and pen with you to jot down the important points. So here, this chapter concentrates on meaning. Meaning in the sense semantics, SEMANTIC. So semantics means meaning. So this chapter, this unit 2, is entirely going to focus on meaning, nature of meaning, how it has to be used by the translator, and it also focuses on the other linguistics aspects of language. Okay, so we understand that every text has a meaning to convey. Why do people attempt to write literary texts? Because they want to convey something. They want to convey some meaning. So the translator who has taken up the task of converting a book from the source language, from SL to target language, from TL, attempts at reproducing this meaning accurately. His aim is to reproduce this meaning, convey whatever was conveyed in that source text, in that original text, that needs to be converted, or that needs to be translated, that needs to be reproduced in the target language. So every text has a meaning, and that meaning the translator should capture properly. Okay, so now coming to meaning, see, we have lots of words. We have plenty of words. These words are called as signs, SIGNS. Okay. We have plenty of signs available with us, available in every language. And these words are called as signs, actually. You should be knowing this. Okay. SIGNS, signs. These words are called as signs. It may be a verbal sign, or it may be a written sign. So, what they mean, what one particular sign means. Suppose this, yesterday I gave you the example of cat. Cat is a sign, cat is a symbol. So what it means, what it expresses by the word, by the combination of alphabet CAT, what are we trying to understand? What does that word try to express? What does that word signify? What does that word intend to mean? Okay, so meaning means the relationship between signs, the signifier and the signified. Okay, what it stands for and what is the real object. So mainly concepts are all in the mind, and we find that meaning is the relationship between signs and what they intend to express. And as I told you, these signs can be both verbal or written, and images, gestures, sounds, and all other ways where information can be coded and sent as a message to anybody who can understand it. So linguistic signs, language signs. Okay, so we see that if some sounds are there, or if some marks are there, or if we find a word in a paper, then we understand that that word possesses some meaning. There should be some meaning for a word, right? So they will be referring to some things. So words themselves have a meaning, or a group of words. We can call a group of words as phrase or a sentence that gives us meaningful sense. Okay? So you should be knowing certain terminologies here, like syntax, phonetics, lexical kind. Okay, so what is syntax? Syntax is arrangement of words and phrases to create well-formed sentence structure. To have a meaningful sentence, words should be arranged in such a way that it gives a proper meaning. So that is syntax. Okay, syntax is nothing but sentence structure. So the composition of a sentence, how are sentences composed? So to compose sentences, they are all governed by grammatical rules, rules governing them. Okay, without grammar, you will not be able to get sensible sentences. So rules govern them. So language occurs in some context only, and language is used to express ourselves, to express our beliefs, our hopes, our intentions, etc. So now to define sign. Sign is an entity that indicates or shows another entity. It shows the existence of something. Sign means what? It shows the existence of something. For example, cat is there. It shows that there is an animal called cat. There exists an animal called cat. Okay. So all the things have meaning, and natural signs are things of the physical world. The ideas are there within the mind. So suppose, you know, there are certain signs which signifies things that are visible to the eye, then we can call them as concrete. Things which are not visible to the physical eyes, then we can call them as abstract ones. So feelings, emotions, etc. come under abstract, and the other objects come under concrete ones. So if we take, we find that there are two things that need to be concentrated upon. Meaningful things are there, non-verbal symbols are there. Non-verbal symbols in the sense, gestures, images, symbols, etc. So when it comes to getting the meaning from something, we can observe two sorts of meaning, two kinds of meaning. The relation that a sign has to the objects. For example, this word cat refers to that animal. Okay, so the sign, CAT, is the sign that refers to the object or objective situations, actual or possible. And then we have the relation a sign has to other signs. Okay, so the mental signs that are conceived as concepts, abstract ones, concepts. Okay, so the sign that relates to objects, or the signs that relate to other objects, and those are called as concepts. So meanings are ideas, what we associate a word with. We associate a word with some ideas, some object. So the mental representations. So what they say is, ideas could be both external or internal, or real, imaginary, all these things. So meaning is all about references. So emphasis is made on references to actual things. So for example, dog, the word dog or the word cat, you know, refers, if we generally say a dog, then we are reminded of the universal animal dog. It is abstract here. It gives an abstract meaning here. But when we say the dog, when we insert an article there, when we insert the article the there, the dog, then it is a referent which is referring to a real life dog. Okay, the dog with which we are familiar with. So generally, if we say dog, then it is a universal animal. When I say the dog, I could mean the dog in my house also. So it all it is all based on the context and things that we are talking about. Now coming to thus we see meanings are got from words. Words are nothing but signs, and these words are linguistic clues. Linguistic, what is linguistic? Study of language. Linguistic clues that are located in the text. So when an author writes something, he expects the text to be meaningful. Without meaning, he wants to convey some meaning. That is what the translator is trying to search in that original book. So meaning that comes from parts of a sentences form meaning of the whole. Meanings are emerged. See this, the first few pages totally talks about meaning only. It is explaining about the nature of meaning, how we have to find what importance it is given. Okay, so meanings are emerged from the words, plus how they are arranged systematically, how these words and phrases are arranged in such a way that well-formed sentences are created. Okay, the sentences which are meaningful are created in such a systematic arrangement of words and phrases. Meaningless structures or sentences are a group of words which do not give any meaning. There is no if a group of words are there but they don't give any meaning, then it is useless. So meaning has many forms. It takes many forms. It might bring about some idea to our minds or talk about some real world entities, about some real existence, about anything. So that is meaning. Now coming to the scientific term of meaning, we have something called as semantics, S-E-M-A-N-T-I-C-S, semantics. Semantics is that branch of linguistics that is concerned with meaning, meaning of a word or meaning of a sentence, or meaning of a paragraph, or meaning of an essay, whatever it is, written form, okay? Semantics is that branch of linguistics that concerns with the meaning of the written form, okay? So here we have two main ideas. One is logical semantics, another one is lexical semantics. So logical semantics, what is this logical semantics? Meaning coming through logicalities. So the sense and reference, what sense is emerging from that? What is the reference through which we are trying to give meanings? Okay, so sense and reference, presupposition and implications. And then these, we have this another type, lexical semantics. So lexical means words, meanings, and the relations between them. Okay, lexical. Lexical means words. So semantics is connected to meanings, meanings of a word, sentence or paragraph or whatever, of any written form. Then we have something called as pragmatics. Pragmatics, study of how language is used by people. What is pragmatics? Pragmatics is the study of how language is used by people, the context in which language is used. Okay, so far we have come across the terminologies like semantics, lexical, pragmatics, etc. So now coming to the descriptive dimensions of meaning. So as I told you, we have the source language text, which is the main text that is waiting to be translated. And then we have the target language text, target text. Okay, so the language in which we are going to translate. So translators get the meaning or the semantic content from source text. So the translators, they get the meaning of whatever the author wanted to convey in the source text and they to put it in the target text. So while doing this, translators should be taking immense care in not trying to misrepresent or misguide. Okay, so semantics refers to the aspects of meaning in a language, code, or other forms of representation. It is totally referring to this aspect of meaning, semantics. Okay, so here we have two words, namely denotation, connotation. So you, these are two important terms which you should be knowing: denotation, connotation. So this semantics also is a theoretical study of meaning in a system of signs. Signs means words. So system of words, system of signs. So to denote something, when I say I want to denote this, to denote something means the primary meaning of the word, literal meaning of the word, which is in contrast to the feelings or ideas that the word suggests. So the relationship between a sign and its objects. So what is this literal meaning? Literal meaning is the direct meaning. As I was telling you, there is a difference between the literal meaning and literary meaning. Free translation, okay? So denotation has everything to do with literal meaning, the direct meaning, and it avoids metaphor. It does not have a flowery language. The denotation is very, the denotative meanings, they are very strict, very literal, and dictionary definition will also come under denotation only. It does not talk about any emotions, attitudes. It does not color the words. The technical manual, see, suppose you get some objects, like you get a mixie or you get some you get some machines that are supposed to be used for any work, then they will also provide the manual. So when in the manual you cannot find any literary language, you will not find language that is very colorful, emotive, or reference oriented. Okay, it will be straight to the point, how to use it, what are the components of that machine, etc. So technical manuals and all will be denotative only. In the sense, they are more literal and they give you direct meaning. Okay. So when writing that, the translator will be taking care to be very accurate, very precise, and it will follow the rules of grammar of the target language also. Okay, so that is denotation. Denotation means literal meaning, free literal and very direct meaning emerges out of that. Okay, it is primary also. Whereas if you come to the opposite of it, connotation, connotation is the idea of feeling which would invoke for a person the literary meaning. Okay, so connotation brings in the feelings, ideas, etc. So it when we are trying to make an interpretation, connotative interpretation, then we are more literary, we are more poetic, etc. So poetry and all, literature, poetry, drama, etc., etc., use connotative language only, okay, which suggests, which is more emotive, which is more referential than being denotative. So literary means the relationship between sign and the signs and other signs. Relationship between the sign and object is literal. Sign and object is denotative. But whereas between the sign and other signs, practical interpretations and all come in literary. Okay. So denotation indicates the relationship between sign and objects. and it is very objective reference, whereas connotation suggests the relation between sign and another sign, and sign and the other signs. It relates how a thing may be associated with a word, feelings, value judgments, etc., etc. So connotation is more subjective, connotation is more cultural oriented, and there is emotional coloring in addition to the open or explicit meaning. Connotation does not give explicit meanings. It is implicit. We have to search for the meanings. We have to associate words with different experiences, with culture, with society, etc., etc. So it is dependent on external sources also. Connotation is dependent on external sources, whereas denotation completely relies on the structure of language, grammatical structure. Okay, so literal meaning denotes denotation, literary meanings is for connotation. So any word or phrase or language, any word, phrase, language, we should, if we are looking for any feelings or any implied value judgment, then it is being more subjective, and that indicates connotation. So in this unit, we see that we are going into much of the linguistics aspects also. Okay, so now we learned these two words, or emphasized on these two words, connotation and denotation, because they play an important role in getting the meaning. Okay, so now why are we more bothered about linguistics in this unit is linguistics, because translation largely depends on linguistics. Translation, the linguistics aspects of a language plays a very important role in translation. Okay, so that is why we are looking at some of the terminologies that are being used in the linguistics topic also. So linguistics generally means study of language, and there we saw what semantics was. Semantics means the study of meaning. It is the interplay of concrete data with theoretical concepts. So on semantic level of words, phrases, sentences, and larger units of discourse, we see how a sentence structure is framed, etc. Discourse na, like any written or spoken communication. Okay, so in that discourse, in that delivery of ideas, how words have been formulated, how words, phrases, sentences, and all have been formulated. Okay, that is what we are studying about. So we see that signs are nothing but the association between the signifier and signified. So again, we are coming to two more terms, signifier and signified. Signifier is the sign, the word that is going to indicate a thing, and signified is the meaning. Okay, suppose we say, let us take the alphabet A. Let us take this alphabet A, which stands for house. Okay, let us take this alphabet A and think that this alphabet A stands for house. Then the letter, the alphabet A, will be the signifier, and the meaning of that house will be the signified. Hope you understand this. The association between signifier and signified. The association between the alphabet A and house. Okay, so A is signifier and house is signified. The association between these two, between the signs, signifier and signified. So when we are looking at these, we look at three large groups of signs. Okay, icon, index, and symbol. Icon, index, and symbol. This is given on page 55 if you have the textbook with you. So on page 55, you have these icon, index, and symbol. You must be knowing what an icon is, what an index is, what a symbol is. Okay, so on the computer, you have certain icons standing for certain things. you have some symbols standing for certain things. For example, the dollar symbol, okay, the dollar symbol, the US dollar symbol, which stands for dollar. So we know it stands for money, the rupee symbol. And then we have on the computers, you have certain icons, the pictographs. So we have some signs also, the pedestrian crossing or the symbols that are there, you know, the colors that are associated with stop, get ready, and you know, you can proceed, things like that. Okay, so the computer icons. So what the author is trying to tell is there is no real connection between the object and an icon of it. Okay, suppose I say cat, I need not compulsorily associate that animal with that, but then language has been framed like that. It has been universally accepted that for that CAT, we associate that small animal. Okay, so the real thing is, the philosophical thing is that there is no real connection between the word and the object, between the sign and the signified, between the signifier and the signified, but we have associated some meaning with some words. So our mind has associated an icon with something, and therefore the understanding of it. Okay, likewise goes the image also, the image of something. Index again, signs only. So symbols represents something in a completely arbitrary relationship. There are no rules that govern this, and they are completely arbitrary. The connection between the signifier and the signified depends on the observer. So symbols are very subjective. See, for me, white may symbolize purity. Okay, white may symbolize purity. For somebody else, white may symbolize blankness, right? So, or for somebody else, it may symbolize the you know, the attachment of white to a widow. Okay, so symbols are subjective. It is very personal, subjective, and it is dictated by social conventions or habits. It is dictated by social conventions or habits. So society plays a very important role in the formulation of language, its significant, its symbols, etc., etc. So like that, for example, words are not connected to physical and logical. So its meaning also gets changed. See, during a period, a word might refer to something else, but during another period, it might refer to something else. Okay, so words have the tendency to change its meaning. In one language, it might mean something. In another language, it might mean something else. Like that, everything happens in the mind only. Symbols are mere ideas only. Okay, symbols are mere ideas only. So likewise, on page 56, they have given something called as semantic field versus semantic context. So semantic refers to meanings. So the field that is full of meanings, what is that semantic field? And what is this semantic context? Semantic field is nothing but you have a group of words, for example. So I said we have plenty of words in English, and to refer to one thing, there are so many words. For example, if I want to talk about the word city, I have numerous other alternatives to refer to that word city. Okay, city means what? Town, or we can call it as a metropolitan, metropolis, cosmopolitan, urban, etc. There again, the opposite of these will be village, rural, etc., etc. So for to refer to the word city, I have this many words: metropolis, cosmopolitan, urban, town, etc. So these group of words which have almost same meaning, except for some minute difference. Okay, there might be a small difference, minute difference for metropolitan, cosmopolitan, urban, city, town, etc. But otherwise, there are a lot of similarities only. So these six words, come under the semantic field. Okay, they are different words meaning the same thing only, but with minute difference. You understand? So what is a semantic field? All these six, seven words form a semantic field to indicate the word city. Okay, so that is semantic field. And then you have this. So here these words retain their individuality. Okay, semantic field is an area of meaning which can be delimited from others in a language. So a range of words are there, a range of there are a possibility for different meanings to come. Only subtle differences are there, minor differences are there. So this range of meanings that cluster around related words is called a semantic field. Okay, so what is this semantic context? Depending upon the need of the text or the semantic context, the writer or translator will choose the appropriate word. So now, what is the duty of the translator? He has to choose. See, there are seven words that could mean the word city, but the translator should now, based on the context in which the source text is based, the tran and how which group is going to receive that after he translates. He is translating for a particular group of people. So that context he has to keep in mind, to whom he for whom he is going to write, who will be the audience of what he is going to write. So for that he has to choose some word. So the writer's duty is to choose an appropriate word from this semantic field. So the choice of words depends on the translator. So the semantic field gives you a number of possibilities, but it lies with the writer or the translator to choose for based on the semantic context, in which context he is going to choose that word. Okay, so for easy understanding, they have given some examples for us. So they say, right from our small days, right from our young days, we have been introduced to this principle actually. So identifying semantic fields, right from our young days, we have been doing that. When they say pick the odd man out, see, home, family, residence, apple. Which is the odd man out here? Home, family, residence, apple. Apple is a fruit, isn't it? It is not connected with home, family, or residence. So the odd man out is apple. So we have identified the semantic fields. Yeah, thank you. Good. So home, family, residence, and apple. So we have been taught right from our childhood days to pick the odd man out. Okay, so that is nothing but identifying semantic fields. So this is the theory of that semantic field, the theory of semantic fields. And then we have, vegetables, fruits, animals, flowers, birds, etc. Again, the principle of learning. We have been taught right from the small days, young days, to choose the semantic field. Okay, so for easy understanding, they have given us this example. So what is this semantic field? Grouping of words which are associated or which define each other could also be a semantic field, they say. Okay, it is composed of a set of words, lexical sets or subfields. Lexical means connected with words. Now, to another important word that we should be learning. So, semim, SEMEMES. It is given on page 57, third paragraph, second paragraph. Okay, second paragraph, second line, third line. So, this word semim, what is this? Semim is the unit of meaning carried by a morpheme. What is a morpheme? It is the smallest unit of meaning in language. Suppose the word dog is there. I already told you, no? Etymology. Okay. What is this etymology? The root word. Okay. So the smallest unit, suppose dog is there, dogs are there, dog manger is there. So from that one root word, many words are derived. So when you divide these words, the smallest unit of that word is called a morpheme. Okay, morpheme. So this semim, what is this semim? Semims are nothing but smaller groupings called lexical sets. Lexical means words, words. Okay, the set of words that compose a semantic field. That compose a semantic field. So as we saw the earlier example, metropolis, cosmopolitan, urban, etc., etc. These are all lexical sets. These are all words. These are all vocabulary. So this small group, this group, no, that's the semantic field. That group that composes a semantic field are called semims. Okay. So three different words associated with the city: metropolis, cosmopolitan, urban. They stand as an example for semantic field. Okay, semantic field. So these words have the same meaning but with slight difference, subtle difference is there, right? So you should be knowing this term also added to this source language, source text, target text, then semantics. You also now have semim. Okay, so semim is nothing but the semantic field is nothing but the sum of the semims. All the words that stands for city are called as semantic field. So the sum of semims are called as semantic field. So now there are some three or four points which we have to look at. Semantic fields of a given word shift over time. That is the first point given on page 58. Semantic fields of a given word shift over time. For example, this word man, okay, human being, adult, male. So there are a lot of words that form the semantic field for this word man. Okay, so man initially during ancient times it referred to the word human being, but today it also refers to the adult male. Okay, so it changes over period of time. Words have a change in their meanings. So no two languages will be having the same meanings. Even in the same language, sometimes there will not be same meanings. So semantic fields has a shift over time. That is what the first point is explaining to you. And then the second point, semantic change is a change in one of the meanings of a word. See, when we have a word, it has a variety of meanings. It has a variety of senses. It has a variety of connotations. So these senses for a word can be added, removed, or changed over time. So they might even mean different things. So that is what they're telling. This is called a semantic change. The meanings of a word will undergo change during a change in the meaning. Okay, the change in the meaning can occur to a word over time. If there will be a shift in the semantic field, they say. And the third point is semantic change is not to be confused with etymology. The etymology of a word, the root of a word will remain the same only, but it is only the meaning that gets changed. Okay. For instance, to explain this point, they give the example of mouse. They give the example of this word mouse. Okay. So the semims that are involved in this word mouse, we call a mouse a rat, rodent, bandicoot, etc. Okay. So this is the semantic field of that animal. Okay, these words, rodent, rat, bandicoot, mouse, these are the different words that stand as a semantic field for this word mouse. Okay, referring to an animal. But nowadays, after the advent of computers, the same mouse stands as a part for the as one of the machine part of the computer. Okay, so this mouse refers to the computer hardware part of the computer. So it has undergone a change. So that is the example for that. Now coming to symbols. Symbols are usually associated with the person's mind and the psychology also. Okay, but we also have accepted symbols. For example, they say that every piece of writing has its own semantic field. Where, and another example they are giving you, earlier example that was given for a semantic field was the word that refers to the city, metropolitan, cosmopolitan, etc. Then they gave you the example of mouse. Now they are giving the example of oil, lubricant. So they say when you use this word oil, you also can refer to it as lubricant, etc. So when in kitchen terminology, they say add some oil to the vegetables and keep it under low flame, then you in that place you cannot substitute that word oil to lubricate because it will not suit that context. Okay, so what they are telling is a translator, when translating from the source text, when translating from the original text, should take immense care in choosing the words. There will be a lot of words, there will be a cluster of semantic fields, but based on the context only, the translator should select the words, and the words that he is selecting should be guided by the semantic context. Okay, the important point here is the translator has to select the appropriate sememe from the semantic field of the word guided by the semantic context. Okay, so what will happen if the translator does not take the appropriate words? What will happen? Then it will lead to semantic mix-up. You are learning another word. See, earlier we learned sememe, semantic sememe, and now we are learning another terminology called a semantic mix-up. When semantic mix-up comes, there will be a total topple over in the understanding of language. Okay, so if the translator is not careful enough, then he will be confused with the words. Okay, suppose there is a poem written on peace, quietness, etc., and when it is a poem of about peace and other things, about the ambience being very quiet and peaceful, etc., for that poem, if the author is going to insert words like bomb, steamroller, violation, etc., then it will be like disturbing the entire sense of the poem. Okay, so what the author is trying to say is the translator should not be caught in this semantic mix-up. You are learning a new word, semantic mix-up, which means wrong meaning will come up there. Okay, ambiguity will come up there, double meaning will come up there. And what will happen if double meaning comes up there, and what will happen if there is ambiguity in a sentence? The reader of the textbook will get confused. Okay, so that should not happen. So the intentional choice for the composition and translation. So when writing, so for technical languages, especially for technical languages, if the author is going to use flowery language, metaphorical language, poetic device and all, then that writing will be a total flop. Okay, so it will not suit that technical language at all. Slangs and all will not suit that writing at all. So that when the translator is trying to translate, he should also keep in mind the subject or the context of what he is translating. And of course, an important point which he has to keep in mind is the target audience. To whom is he writing? Okay, so the reader is very, very important. He cannot talk about acting techniques that are involved in drama to a general public, because the general public may not be interested in dramatic techniques. And he cannot, it will suit only the students of a film institute. So likewise, you know, there are a lot of examples. So when the translator is translating, he has to keep in mind all these things. So he cannot think about mixing metaphors. He cannot think about, using wrong semimes from semantic field, etc., etc. especially when he's writing about in imaginative writing, especially in imaginative writing, he should not come up with this semantic mix-up. Okay, usually the semantic mix-up will happen in punning, irony, and the other devices that are used for literary purposes. The literary devices, you know what a pun is. Okay, a joke with different meanings for a word. We would be trying to convey something, and the reader would understand something else. So this should not happen during punning and irony, usage of irony, etc. Okay, so the translator should take care enough in avoiding double meanings. So this is what they're trying to explain on page 62, where they are doing explaining it with the help of a form for you, where this word adder is there, which means a snake, as well as an accountant, which finally leads to misrepresentation, or this serves as an example for semantic mix-up. The meaning gets mixed up and leads the readers to confusion. So now they move on to something called as a communicative event. What is communicative event? In the act of communication in translation, so actually a question is there, okay? In sample questions, you have the fifth one is components of communicative event. What are the components of communicative event? So when we are trying to communicate, when the translator is trying to translate a piece into the target language, into TL, these three components are most important. One is the translator, the person who communicates. The author who communicates is called the translator. And then the second component is the person who receives it, the reader. It is only for the readers that we are writing, isn't it? So reader, and then the item of communication, that is the textbook. So thus we see that it is only because of the reader that the textbook comes alive. If the reader does not take a textbook and start reading, the book is dead only. There is no life in the book unless the reader comes in touch with the textbook. So these are the three components of the communication. Okay, so translation is thus a bilingual process. Two languages are involved, and the communicative event is a composition of source language, target language, and the translator. Okay, so what they say is communicative difference should not come between source language and target language. When will this communicative difference come? When the translation is made word for word. See, one school of thought, they support this word for word translation. They say that translation should be faithful and literal. Another school says, no, it should not be word for word translation. It should be sense for sense translation, where it will not be faithful and literal to the original work. Rather, it will be meaningfully equivalent and dynamic, and bring the source, bring the spirit of the original text, as we discussed yesterday. So while translating, the translator will have the tendency to make intentional changes and unintentional changes. Okay, so what is this intentional changes? So while translating, these intentional changes will occur frequently when the aim is different from that of the source text, and when there is a difference between the target language and the source language, and when there is a change in the reading circle. So all this will lead to intentional changes. And now coming to linguistic approaches to meaning. Linguistic approaches to meaning. So we already saw some of the terminologies. Now they are introducing us on page 64 to linguistics. Linguistics, as I told you earlier, is the scientific study of language. And one who is involved in this linguistics, one who is involved in this scientific study of language is called a linguist. So linguistics can either be theoretical or applied. Okay, there we also have a branch called applied linguistics, where language is connected with the practical aspects, with social functions, where language is very important for expressing and communicating language. And any translator, any person who's involved in translation should be very proficient in both the languages, both source language and target language, both English and Tamil, or English and Hindi, whatever it is, or in Tamil and English, whatever it is. Okay. So in this unit, we will be emphasizing on these words: morphology, syntax, semim, semantic, linguistics, all these words. So we'll just see one by one. Morphology is the study of word structure. What is morphology? Is the study of word structure, how words are structured, the linguistic strings. It is called as linguistic strings. Okay. Then we have the syntax. Syntax is the study of sentence structure. Morphology means the study of word structure. Syntax means the study of sentence structure. Then we have semim. Semim is the smaller grouping of words. I told you, no? Semims altogether comprise the semantic field. Okay, so all these things. Then you have the phonetics. Phonetics. What is phonetics? Study of sounds. Phonology, system of sounds, study of sounds. What is syntax? Syntax is arrangement of words and phrases to form sentence structures. So all these scientific terms of this subject, linguistics, are governed by grammatical rules. They are governed by grammatical rules. So grammar governs them. Without grammar, there is no language. So the grammar of one language is different from the grammar of another language. That is why the structure of the language is most important. The structure of sentences, for phrases, words, everything is very important. That is why they say that the translator should be well versed, should have command over both the languages. That is why it is said that the translator should have command over both the languages. So then under descriptive dimensions of meaning, we have something called as dialect and sociolect. So what is this dialect? Dialect is the language spoken by a particular group of people. So it all diff see, you have to understand that the translator who's translating in the target language should be well versed in the culture of the language that he is translating also. So the ethnicity of a place, the ethnicity, the race, the culture, the religion, status, gender, level of education, in which society is going to present the textbook, all these are very, very important. So dialects, sociolects. Okay. What is the language that is used among some social classes? That is sociolects. So you have internal language and external language. So what is this internal language? Internal language analyzes syntax and semantics in a very simple manner, in an abstract manner, whereas external one involves social context, outside theory. Okay. So for a person to translate, he should have the knowledge of grammar of both the languages, of source language and target language. And he should have the ability to reconstitute the source text. He should capture the spirit of the original text. He should capture the spirit of the original source language. Okay. And he should also capture the style of the text. He should do it with an ease of the original composition. So again, the phonology, he has to be well versed in the phonology of both the languages, the phonemes, morphology, the sentence structures, and all these are governed by the rules of grammar. Okay, all these have specific patterns. The translator should be well versed in these specific patterns, and he should be well versed in the vocabulary. He should be known, he should be knowing what word he has to use for a particular context. So one, when doing this, one difficulty that the translators experience is multiple meanings should not emerge. Okay. If more than one meaning comes, or if he is what the original writer intended to say and what he was telling, when there is a mismatch in that, misrepresentation in that, then they will be taken to task. The other day, yesterday, we also saw how a writer for misrepresentation, for bringing about mismatching in the translation, he was also tried and executed. So sometimes, you know, this kind of difficulties arise for the translator. So the translator has to be very, very careful. So they have given some examples relating to fish, bank, run, etc. Okay. So bank na, which bank is referred to? The financial bank or the river bank? Which translation should the translator choose? So the machine translation is there, human beings translation is there, translation of the translator is there. So the person should be efficient and skilled in translating in both the languages. He should be very careful about the general language and specialized terminology. Okay. So in general language, sometimes, you know, when we are translating, some words will get repeated. So if words are repeated, then it will lead to dullness. It will lead to monotony. So, but this cannot be avoided in specialized terminology. In technical concepts, repetition should not be avoided because it will lead to, you know, ambiguity of sentences, ambiguity of words. So we the translator should take immense care in trying to differentiate between this general vocabulary and specialized term. Okay. So where specialized term should be used, where general term to be used. So very jokingly on page 73, they say, suppose there is a person is writing a letter to one Mr. Bill. Okay. But the machine, if it doesn't know that this Bill is a person, then it will translate as, suppose the letter begins like Dear Bill, translation will become like Beloved Invoice. The bill will be taken for invoice. So it is good for the translator to know the both the languages in a very proficient, skilled manner. And on page 73, you have some of the characteristics that are given for good translation. Where a good translation should be fluent, smooth, idiomatic, easily understandable, etc., etc. You can read those 9 points and you will have a better understanding of that. Okay. And they have also given about the linguistic meaning of forms. What is this linguistic meaning of forms? See, you have three types: linguistic meaning, referential meaning, and emotive meaning. Linguistic meaning refers to meaning refers to everything that is within the language itself, within the construction of language itself. It does not refer to anything outside of language. Everything comes within the construction itself. Whereas referential points out at external things. See, there are three types of meanings: linguistic meanings, referential meanings, and emotive meanings. Emotive meanings and referential meanings have things to do outside language. Okay. So linguistic meaning is based on the structure of the language, how a sentence is structured, how a paragraph is designed like that. So that is why on page 74, they have given this qualifier. What is a qualifier? It is a tall tree, gray horse. What is an actor? John left. Some action has been performed. That is why they call it as an actor. Then relation, through the house. So what is the relation? Then the delimiter, this man. So there is a limit, this man, one child. Okay. So these all come under linguistic meaning. Linguistic meaning is, it is all within the language. Okay. That is why translators should go in for generative type of grammar, they say. Why generative grammar is, generative device is important for translators is because it gives a translator a technique for analysis and interpretation of source text. So he can use apt expressions for target language. That is why generative type of grammar is very, very essential. Okay. So apart from this linguistic meaning, we also have something called as referential meaning. So we said linguistic meaning is completely dependent on the language, the completely dependent on language within
within the construction, whereas referential refers to outside. There will be an outside reference, and it is psychological also. It is psychological also. It is based on our emotions. So you can just read these. It is easy only. Thus, you know, we see that unit 2 full and full concentrates on it fully concentrates on the linguistic aspects of a language, because without expertizing the linguistic aspects, you cannot go in for translation. So any doubts, please feel free to ask me, okay? I think it's time for the next class. So I'll wind up with this. We complete, thus we have completed unit 2. In the next class, we'll move on to unit 3. Meanwhile, if you have any doubts, feel free to ask me. My phone number is also there, okay? Yeah, thank you. Thank you, thank you.
Dear students, continue. I told last class I will provide you with the details of the characters in the play Macbeth. Is it clear now? Clear now?
Okay. You may ask that I will provide you with the details of the characters of Macbeth. Who are all the characters in the play Macbeth? The dramatis personae in Macbeth:
Duncan is the king of Scotland. Next, Donalbain and Malcolm are the sons of Duncan. Then we have the two generals of the king's army, Macbeth and Banquo
are the two generals of the king's army of Scotland. Then we have Macduff, Lennox, Ross, Menteith, Angus.
They are said to be the noble men of Scotland. Let me repeat it again. Macduff, Lennox, Ross, Menteith, and Angus. They are the noble men of Scotland. Then we have Fleance. Fleance, who is the son to Banquo.
Then we have Siward, 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 Earl of Northumberland.
Then his son, young Siward. We have Seyton, 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 an officer attending on Macbeth. Then we have a boy, son to Macduff. We have two doctors in the play, an English doctor, a Scottish doctor, a soldier, a porter, an old man. Then there are three women characters in the play: Lady Macbeth, Lady Macduff, and a gentlewoman whose name is not given. She is called a gentlewoman. So Lady Macbeth, Lady Macduff.
A gentlewoman who attends on Lady Macbeth, who is an attendant to Lady Macbeth.
Then we have the supernatural beings, the three witches. These are the characters in the play Macbeth. Now we will come back to the play. We'll continue our stance with the play. See, after Macbeth was killed, an epitaph was written on the tomb of Macbeth, an epitaph. What is written on the epitaph?
This dead butcher and his fiend-like queen. So this is the epitaph that Malcolm gives to Macbeth. Dead butcher. That is how Macbeth is called by Malcolm.
Malcolm's epitaph on the murderers of his father is understandably harsh. There's a harsh way of addressing Macbeth, because here Malcolm's epitaph, see, on the murderers of his father, when his father is murdered, that shows the angriness of Malcolm.
See, in all the plays, in all the tragedies, see, whereas Hamlet has flights of angel to sing him. Whereas Hamlet has flights of angel to sing him to his rest. Antony and Cleopatra are eulogized by their chief enemy.
Even the arch enemy eulogizes
when Antony and Cleopatra die. There are angels to sing a song at the death of Hamlet.
Coriolanus is praised by his assassin. Even the assassin praises Coriolanus. And even the wife murderer, Othello,
is complimented after his suicide on his greatness of heart. The hellhound Macbeth has no one to speak for him. See, even at the time when these characters die, there are people who praise them. But here, when we look at the death of Macbeth, when we look at the character of Macbeth, when we look at Macbeth, he is hellhound. This hellhound Macbeth has no one to speak for him, no one to praise him, no one to speak for him. And Samuel Johnson commented on the play in his edition. He expressed the general view that the patients are directed to their true end.
Lady Macbeth is merely detested. And though the courage of Macbeth preserves some esteem, yet every reader of the play feels happy at his fall. Every reader rejoices at the fall of Macbeth. That is why Malcolm is right in calling Macbeth as the dead butcher, because he behaved like a butcher throughout his reign of Scotland.
Although the play has been described as Shakespeare's most profound and mature vision of evil, a statement of evil, and a play about damnation. This is called a play about damnation. Macbeth is called a play about damnation. Macbeth is said to be Shakespeare's most profound and mature vision of evil. Even they go on calling the play as a statement of evil.
It is plain that in order to show how the hero comes to be damned, Shakespeare had to describe and create the good which Macbeth had sacrificed.
See, in the opening,
scenes of the play, the opening act, the first act of the play, we find Macbeth. Everyone praises Macbeth for his valor. Every other character, all the characters have high praise for Macbeth because of his brave, because of his courage, because of his valor. He has fought for the sake of the country. He has won battles for the country. And so he is all praised by everyone. Every other character you find, every other character praise Macbeth for his heroic deeds, for his heroic actions.
And Duncan was all praise for Macbeth. And whenever his name is mentioned, we find people addressing him as brave Macbeth, noble Macbeth. That is how he is addressed in the opening act of the play. The first act of the play, whenever his name is mentioned, it is always prefixed with a very good adjective. Brave Macbeth, courageous Macbeth, noble Macbeth. Dear kinsman, that is how he is addressed in the opening act of the play. But see, all the adjectives that has been employed, all the adjectives that have been employed in the description of Macbeth became in the last speech of Malcolm, you find him being addressed as dead butcher. This is the fall of the man. This is how he is damned. And that is why it is called a tragedy of damnation. A play about damnation.
His fall from grace, from superior place. He enjoyed a superior place. From that, he falls because of his ambition.
Overvaulting ambition. Because of his vaulting ambition. Vaulting ambition to achieve greatness. Vaulting ambition to occupy the throne.
So it is this ambition which makes Macbeth fall from his grace. This makes him fall from his grace.
This is a fall from where he could never escape. He kept on falling. He wants to achieve greatness, occupying the throne by becoming a king. At least after that, he could have avoided doing misdeeds. He could have avoided doing evil. But he continues doing evil even after achieving his ambition. And he could never come back. He could never return to his original state. The original state that was mentioned in the earlier act of the play.
In some ways, Macbeth resembles the murderer and usurper
like Richard III and like Claudius. He is led from crime to crime. He is led from crime to crime. See, crime breeds another crime. He moves from crime to crime in the attempt to achieve security. Once he got the throne, he is never satisfied because he never felt to have been secure. So he wants to achieve security. In order to achieve, he keeps on doing evil actions. So he comes crime to crime. That is movement of character. He is led from crime to crime in order to achieve security. The nice version of the previous lines. Shakespeare wished to get under the skin of a murderer and to show that for the defense, though extenuating thing, can make us feel a kinship with his client, can make us recognize that if we had been so tempted, we too might have fallen. It's a temptation. It's a temptation that he got from, that he received from his noble partner. That is how he addresses That is how Macbeth addressed his wife in his letter. My noble partner. So noble, noble partner. So Macbeth is a miserable and a banished and a damned creature. Macbeth is a miserable and a banished and a damned creature. Yet he is God's creature still and contributes something to his glory even in his damnation. Macbeth is a noble and gifted man. A noble man and gifted man. The gift is his bravery, his strength, his courage, his nobility, his valor. These are the glories that he got from heaven. So Macbeth is a noble and gifted man who chooses misery and crime. It is his own choice. It's his own making. It's his own making. The fall from grace is his own making. His own ambition. Who chooses treachery and not believing he has any justification for deeds, but knowing precisely for what they are. In Macbeth, the evil is transferred from the villains to the hero and heroine. Normally, the protagonist of the play will never be a villain. Here we have protagonists. We have the hero and the heroine. The hero and the hero here are villains. So evil is not outside and evil is within them. So in Macbeth, evil is transferred from villain to the hero and heroine. By the evil embodied the weak. So the weak is the three witches. The three witches had a tremendous impact on Macbeth. Evil was evil. So they are evil. The witches are evil. And they know evil and they found Macbeth an evil man. And that is why they were able to identify evil. They identified Macbeth. They didn't identify other characters. The witches didn't identify any other characters. There is Banquo. We have Banquo. When they approached Macbeth, Banquo was very well with him. But they didn't speak to Banquo. They spoke to Macbeth because they know very well, the witches very well, that Macbeth is evil. Only a good can identify a good person. In the similar way, only evil persons can identify evil persons. Here, they could identify, the witches could identify that Macbeth is like them. Macbeth is also an evil man, like them, like the witches. And here Shakespeare makes Duncan venerable and saintly. Duncan is venerable, highly respectable, and he is saintly. Duncan is venerable and saintly. Malcolm, an image of perfection. Malcolm is an image of perfection. Macduff, a righteous avenger. Macduff, a righteous avenger. The long scene in England contrasts the portrait of a good king with the tyrant he pretends to be. And the account of Edward the Confessor's powers presents a supernatural to counterbalance the evil of the weird sisters. Apart from these things, it's by the imagery and symbolism that the good is presented. The contrast in the play, you find a contrast between light and darkness. The contrast between light and darkness symbolizes a general contrast between good and evil, devils and angels, hell and heaven. The disease images clearly reflect both the sin
which is a disease, and Macbeth himself, who is the disease from which Scotland suffers. Macbeth himself is a disease from which Scotland suffers. And Lady Macbeth wins largely by appealing to Macbeth's valor. All through the play, you find Lady Macbeth winning largely by appealing to Macbeth's valor. And one of the critics, Cleon Brooks, in his well-known essay, writes on his appeal, on her appeal to his manliness. So here, as Adam yielded to the temptation of Eve, here you find Macbeth yielding to the temptation of Lady Macbeth. And again, there also you find a fall. Here too we have a fall. The fall of Macbeth. Yielding to the temptation. All through the play, Shakespeare continuously juggles with the different meanings of honor, military honor, honor bestowed by a king, free honors, mouth honors. The ambiguity in the word is brought out in the exchange between Macbeth and Banquo just before the murder of Duncan. Closely connected with the word honor are the feudal ideas of duties. Feudal ideas of duties and service, the repetition of which helps to create a picture of an orderly and closely knit society in contrast to the disorder consequent upon Macbeth's initial crime. The Macbeth's initial crime is the crime that he commits in murdering his own king. So it's a regicide. Macbeth has indulged in regicide by killing his own king. The naturalness of the order and the unnaturalness of its violation by Macbeth are emphasized by several images throughout the play. The images of planting and sowing. The images of planting and sowing. And the images of sleep and mill contrast with the images of unnatural disorder. Unnatural disorder and the reiteration of fear and blood. The contrast is most apparent. The contrast is most apparent in the lines which express so violently Lady Macbeth's violation of Essex. Because in every, whenever Macbeth wants to, feels to shun away from the action, whenever he feels to shun away from the action, it is Lady Macbeth who encourages him, who gives him courage to do the deed, to commit the action, to do the deed. But such means order of nature and examines the nature of order so that the violation of order in the state, in the murder of Duncan, is seen to be unnatural horror. Unnatural horror. A deed true trouble to behold. Inevitably at potence. The presentation of the good counterbalances the evil is done most effectively through Macbeth of unwilling who are access to their renounce. Macbeth is bad from the very beginning. That he contemplates evil. Macbeth knows very well. But very well. Macbeth is very much aware from the beginning. He is thinking that he contemplates is evil. He admits his horrid image makes his hair. The horrid image makes his hair stand on end when his heart knock against his ribs.
If I am good, that's what he asks. If I am good, why should I yield to the suggestion whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my seated heart knock at my ribs? That's what he states. He admits
that. Is it clear now, Zan? He admits that his horrid image makes his hair stand on end and his heart knock against his ribs. Although he never discusses with his wife the morality of the murder, which she always mentions euphemistically, if it is done, that's what she says. If it is done, if it were done. So it's a reference to, they keep on referring to it. They never use the word murder. If it is done, when it is done, if it were done, they keep on using the word, substituting the word it. So that's a way of euphemism. She always mentions euphemistically, and although he hardly faces it himself, every word he speaks shows that he is struck to the soul with the realization of the horror of the deed, the horror of the action. The half-demented language he uses immediately after the murder expresses fear. See, as soon as it's over, as soon as the action is over, as soon as the action is over, he says, he informs his wife, he says, he feels guilty. He feels guilty of the action. What makes him guilty? That he has not murdered Duncan alone, he has also killed Sleep. There is a voice, sleep no more. There is a voice, he heard a voice, sleep no more. Macbeth had killed Sleep, sleep no more. That started reverberating in his ears, sleep no more. Glamis hath murdered Sleep. Glamis hath murdered Sleep. Kedar shall sleep no more. It's Glamis who hath murdered Sleep, because when we are introduced, Macbeth is the Thane of Glamis. Then he is raised to the position Thane of Kedar. Then he usurped the throne by murdering the king, Duncan, and becomes the king of Scotland. So they cried, there is a cry, sleep no more. Glamis hath murdered Sleep. Kedar shall sleep no more. Macbeth is never in doubt of the difference between good and evil. Nor is Lady Macbeth. Not even in the speech in which she deliberately chooses evil as a means of achieving goodness. Achieving the good of the crown, inexorably, the action runs home the moral that all the perfumes, and she realizes in the later part of the play, when Macbeth was so pathetic in his expression, when Macbeth tells his wife that he feels his hands are blood in color. He could see his hands blood in color. Where she says, Macbeth is highly imaginative. When he tells his wife that even if he dips his hand in the ocean will turn red. That's what he says. So my hands are full of blood. He feels his hands to be full of blood. And also, he feels that nothing can clear away the blood in his hand. Where Lady Macbeth tells him, a little water clears us of this deed. A little water clears us of this action. My husband, don't go mad. Don't go mad. Don't imagine yourself. A little water. Why are you so imaginative that your hands will turn the ocean to red. Don't tell like that, a little water clears us of this deed. Whereas in the later part of the play, in the last act of the play, you find Lady Macbeth going repeatedly, going towards the tap, opening the tap and washing her hands. She keeps on washing her hands.
Out, and she looks at the hand and says, out, out, damned spot. She looks at the hands and says, out, out, damned spot, because she finds the spot there. She finds the spot of blood in her hands in the later part of the play. At the end of the play, you find in the fifth act, you find Lady Macbeth in her sleepwalking, going towards the tap and opening the tap and washing her hands time and again. Time and again, she washes her hands and tells that was the shuddering cry of Lady Macbeth. That was the shuddering cry of Lady Macbeth, where she says, who would have thought the old man here is drunken. Who would have thought the old man to have had so much blood in him? Who would have thought the old man to have had so much blood in him? Because she keeps on washing her hands, yet she could not get her wiped out. She could not get her hands wiped out. Wiped out of the spot of blood. Who would have thought? Still it is bleeding. Duncan is still bleeding. Bleeding in my hands. So this is a kind of psychological nervousness, psychological disorder that she felt in her brain. Who would have thought the old man to have so much blood in him? She doesn't stop with that. She doesn't stop with almost to the extent of saying, all the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand. She goes to the extent of saying that all the perfumes, see, a little water clears us of this deed. This was the line spoken by Lady Macbeth when Macbeth was imaginative. When Macbeth was highly imaginative, she said that a little water clears us of this deed. A little water will clear us of this action. The same Lady Macbeth tells in the fifth act of the play, the first scene of the fifth act of the play, all the perfumes of Arabia, here is blood still. Here is the smell of blood still. Here is the smell of blood still. Whenever she takes her hands towards her nose, she could find the smell of blood. Out, out, damned spot. Here is the smell of blood still. Here is the smell of blood still. It is still, I could, he is still feel the smell of blood in my hands. All the perfumes of Arabia. All the perfumes of Arabia. Even if I pour all the perfumes of, even if I wash my hands with all the perfumes of Arabia, it will not clean my hand. I could, even after that, the smell of blood will be there. All the perfumes of Arabia will not clean this little hand. See, look at the change. That's I'm telling these lines in order to make you understand the change that occurred. The change that occurred in the course of the play. The change that Lady Macbeth experienced. Whereas in the case of Macbeth, a little water clears us of this. In the case of Macbeth, who is very much afraid, became bolder afterwards. Who appeared to be bolder in the first two acts of the play, she becomes weak in the latter part of the play, because Lady Macbeth started realizing her heinous deeds. Lady Macbeth realized her crime. That is why she speaks like that. A Macbeth who feels the horror of the deed as Shakespeare's hero
would not be able to commit it. The argument is that Shakespeare sacrificed psychological consistency. Psychological consistency to theatrical effect. It's only fair to Shakespeare to add, and Stoll did not always make full allowance for this. The idea, that ideas about what is psychologically possible, what is psychologically possible, change from age to age. And that is what Bridges, one of the critics, thought impossible, seemed perfectly possible to the readers of Timothy Bright, and even to judge from criticism of the play, right down to the end of the century. Lady Macbeth, however, accuses her husband of having forced the murder before Duncan announced his intention of being their guest. Before time and place cohered. This made one of the critics, Coleridge, argue that the murder had been discussed before the opening of the play, and led one of the critics, Bradley, to suggest if they had had ambitious conversations in which each felt that some half-formed guilty idea was floating in their minds, was floating in the mind of the other. Half-formed guilty idea was floating in the mind of the other, she might naturally take the words of the letter as indicating much more, it is said. And Macbeth, it is probable to say that this is the shortest of all tragedies, and also it was said to be the last written of the four great tragedies. And this preceded Antony and Cleopatra. And in that play, Shakespeare's final style appears for the first time completely formed. Much more decidedly in Macbeth than in other plays. Macbeth, in many aspects, other plays of Shakespeare. Shakespeare in tragedy, as a rule, has a special or a kind of its own, quite acceptable, however difficult. The effect of this atmosphere is marked with unusual strength, in Macbeth, and it is due to a variety of influences which combine with those noticed so that darkness, we may even say blackness, occupies this tragedy, which at once recur to memory, take place either at night or in some dark spot. When we look at the whole play, in most of the scenes, number of scenes, either happen in night or in dark spot. So nothing happens in light. So darkness pervades the entire play. So the vision of the dagger, the murder of Duncan, the murder of Banquo, the sleepwalking of Lady Macbeth, all come in night scenes. All the scenes, when we look at the scenes, when we look at the most important scenes, the dagger that appears in the vision of Macbeth, the dagger that asks Macbeth to clutch and get hold of it to murder Duncan, the vision of dagger
The murder of Duncan, the murder of Banquo. Banquo was murdered in the night. Duncan was murdered when he was asleep. All the scenes, the sleepwalking scene of Lady Macbeth, all come in night scenes. All these actions take place only in night. The witches, before sitting, before, where shall we meet? When shall we meet? Before the setting of sun. The witches dance in the thick air of a storm. Our black and midnight hags receive Macbeth in a cavern. The blackness of night is to the hero a thing of fear. The blackness of night is to the hero a thing of fear, even of horror, and which he feels become the spirit of the play. The faint glimmerings of the western sky at twilight are here menacing. It is the hour, it is the time where he feels, it is the hour when the traveler hastens to reach safety in his inn, and Banquo rides homeward to meet his assassins, the hour when light thickens. Night's black agents to their prey do rouse, when the wolf begins to howl and the owl to scream. Everything happens in night. And Macbeth bids the stars to hide their fires, that his black disease may be concealed. Stars, hide your faces. He commands stars. He appeals to stars, all the stars. He appeals to bodies. He makes an appeal to heavenly bodies. He appeals to the stars. What's the appeal? Hide your faces. He appeals to stars to hide their faces, so that there won't be even an iota of light. There won't be light. Macbeth bids the stars to hide their fires, that his black disease may be concealed. So that his disease may be concealed. His black disease. The black disease is evil desires, evil ambitions. Black desires will be hidden. Black desires may be sealed. Lady Macbeth calls on thick night. She calls on come, hell done, the smoke of hell. Let it be hell. Let it be, let it resemble a hell, dun smoke hell. The moon is down and no stars shine when Banquo, dreading the events, night goes unwillingly to bed and leaves Macbeth for the summons of the little bell. When the next day should dawn, its light is strangled and darkness does the face of the earth entomb. In the whole drama, the sun to shine only twice. In the whole play, in the whole drama, there are only two occasions. We come across only occasions where we find the sun shining. It's beautiful but ironical passage follows, sitting around the castle, and afterwards, at the close, the arriving army gathers to read the end of its tale. These are the two occasions. The failure of nature in Lady Macbeth is marked by her fear of darkness. In the sleepwalking scene, she always wants to keep a taper behind her. She always wants a candle behind her. She is afraid of darkness because it is in darkness evil things happen. She is very much afraid of evil. She is very much afraid of darkness. This is the metamorphosis that we find in the character of Lady Macbeth. The failure is a failure of nature in Lady Macbeth is marked by her fear of darkness.
She has light with her continually. She kept with her light continually. And in the one phrase of fear that escapes her lips, even in sleep, it is of the darkness of the place of torment that she speaks. The atmosphere of Macbeth, however, is not that of unrelieved blackness. On the contrary, as compared with other plays, Macbeth leaves a decided impression of color. It is really the impression of a black night broken by flashes of light and color, sometimes vivid and even glaring. They are the lights and colors of the thunderstorm. Lights and colors of the thunderstorm in the first scene. Of the dagger hanging before me and sitting alone, sharpness of the dagger. Sharpness of the dagger glittering alone in the midnight air. Of the torch borne by the servant when he and his lord come upon Banquo crossing the castle court to his room. Of the torch again which Fleance carried to light his father to death and which was dashed out by one of the murderers. Of the torches that flared in the hall on the face of the ghost and the blanched cheeks of Macbeth. Of the flames beneath the boiling cauldron from which the apparitions in the cavern rose. These are all the places where we come across light and it is not natural light. These are all not natural light. These are all lights of the torch. The taper, which showed to the dark and gentlewoman the wasted face and blank eyes of Lady Macbeth. And above all, the color is the color of blood. It cannot be an accident that the image of blood is forced upon the readers continually, not merely by the events themselves, but by full descriptions and even by reiteration of the word in unlikely parts of the dialogue. The witches, after their first wild appearance, have hardly quitted the stage when they staggers on to eat a bloody man gashed with wounds. His tale, Macbeth's tale, is of a hero whose brandished steel smoked with the bloody execution. I quote from the first act of the play. He kept a brandished steel smoked with the bloody execution. He carved out a passage for victory. It's Macbeth who carved out a passage for victory in the battlefields. And then he tells of a second battle so bloody that combatants seemed as if they meant to bathe in reeking wounds. What metaphors! What a dreadful image is that with which Lady Macbeth greets us almost as she enters. When she prays, the spirits of cruelty so to thicken her blood that pity cannot flow her veins. She appeals to all gods. She appeals to all gods to thicken her blood. Only when the blood gets thickened, she can indulge in evil action. She can commit even evil action. So greets us almost as she enters. When she prays, the spirits of cruelty, she appeals to the spirits of cruelty to thicken her blood. So to thicken her blood. Why does she want to thicken her blood? That pity cannot flow along her veins. If she becomes sympathetic, then she may refrain from doing evil actions. She may refrain from doing evil deeds. What pictures are those of the murderer appearing at the door of the banquet room with Banquo's blood upon his face? Of Banquo himself with 20 trenched gashes on his head.
Blood ball third, of Macbeth gazing at his hand and watching it die, the whole green ocean red, 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 blood. Of Lady Macbeth gazing at hers and stretching it away from her face to escape the smell of blood, to escape the smell of blood, that all the perfumes of Arabia will not subdue. And the most horrible lines in the whole play, the most horrible lines in the whole of tragedy are those of her shuddering cry. I quote, I told you earlier, I quoted this line earlier. These are said to be the most horrible lines in the whole of the play. The whole tragedy, in the whole play, are those of her shuddering cry. Who would have thought? Yet, who would have thought the old man to have had so much blood in him? And it is not only at such moments that these images occur. Even in the quiet conversation of Malcolm and Macbeth, Macbeth is imagined as holding a bloody scepter. Even they spoke, even Malcolm and Macduff felt that the scepter itself is bloody. The crown is full of blood. It's a bloody scepter. And Scotland, as a country bleeding, the entire country is bleeding. Every man that we come across in the play, these lines, I quote, every man, new widows howl, new widows cry. This is the condition of Scotland. This is the condition of Scotland under the rule of Macbeth. Every morning, you find new widows. Every morn, new widows howl, the howling of new widows. The crying of new orphans. This is what you hear every day in the rule of Macbeth. So the whole country is bleeding. The entire country is bleeding during the rule of Macbeth. It's a country which is bleeding. Scotland as a country bleeding. And receiving every day a new gash, a new gash added to her wounds. Every day the country is wounded. The country feels the wound every day. It is as if the poet saw the whole story through an ensanguined mist, and as if it stained the very blackness of the night. When Macbeth, before Banquo's murder, invokes night to scarp off the eye of pitiful day, to tear in pieces the great bond that keeps him pale, even the invisible hand that is to tear bond is imagined as recovered with blood. The vividness, magnitude, and violence of the imagery in some of these passages are characteristic of Macbeth almost throughout, and their influence contributes to form its atmosphere. Images like those of the babe torn smiling from the breast and dashed to death. Of pouring the sweet milk of Concord into hell. Of the earth shaking in fever. The earth shaking in fever. Frame of things disjointed. Sorrows striking heaven on the face. The mind full of scorpions. The mind full of scorpions. When Macbeth speaks after the murder of Banquo, he tells the readers, and he tells his wife, that we have scotched the snake, not killed it. We are keeping the snake in our hands, not killed it. So when we have committed evil, the evil is in our hands. So crime, from crime to crime, that's what I told earlier. From moving from crime to crime, one crime to another crime. Crime breeding more crimes.
mind full of scorpions, the mind lying in restless ecstasy on a rack. A tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury, all keep the imagination moving on a wild and violent sea, while it is rarely